I'd like to call to order the workshop meeting for the Village of Lisle Board of Trustees, Monday, November 13th, 2017. Assistant Village Clerk, will you please call the roll?
Mayor Pisak?
Here.
Trustee Boyle?
Here.
Trustee Carvalho is absent. Trustee Kowitzel?
Here.
Trustee Dixit?
Here.
Trustee Hasse?
Here.
Trustee Mandel is absent. Village Manager Ertmo?
Here.
Acting Community Development Director Herman?
Here.
Finance Director Schiller?
Here.
Chief of Police Anderson?
Here.
Public Works Director Elias?
Here.
Economic Development Coordinator Kelly?
Here.
Staff Engineer Stormwater Administrator Suco?
Here.
Deputy Village Clerk Recording Secretary Arnold?
Here.
And I'm Deputy Clerk Curran.
I'd like to ask everybody to stand for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. And the first item, second item on our agenda, but first real item, concrete block exterior construction.
Yes. So through the FEMA Hazard Mitigation Assistance Grant, there's five houses that the village will be purchasing for a number of reasons. And Marilyn's here, and she could speak maybe a little bit more about those if necessary.
Can I do a quick correction? We're not purchasing, we're elevating.
Thank you. These five homes are being elevated. The architect has advised that they'd like to use a decorative concrete block for the foundation, but due to some eligibility criteria, they're unable to then further provide exterior finish for purely aesthetic reasons over that concrete block. So staff looking into it, we have a section in our code, our building code, that prohibits the use of exposed concrete block exterior wall. This has been in the village code since 1972. Since that time, you know, there's a number of new construction techniques, various types of concrete block faces, either decorative or referred to as architectural block faces, and also there's poured concrete methods that end up with the appearance of a exposed concrete block exterior. We've also reached out to a few of our neighboring communities, and for the most part, those communities not have similar prohibitions on exposed concrete block construction. So staff, we're seeking direction from the village board as to whether those five grant recipients should seek a building code variance to potentially allow the use of the decorative concrete block. Alternatively, the thought would be if the board is comfortable, we could actually propose a text amendment to the code, and that text amendment would either be to just eliminate that provision in the code entirely, or alternatively to amend the code to allow a decorative or architectural concrete block construction but prohibit a unfinished smooth-faced concrete block. And there's some images here of various types. Split face is very common, and I believe that's what the grant recipients would be using, is a type of split face concrete block. There's a few more examples as well on the screen. And then the next page shows just, you know, kind of an example of what that would look like for the foundation for a lower level on an elevated home, that concrete block construction. And any questions?
Well, from my perspective, this is a solution starting for those five homes, and could roll out for a greater
Yes, that's why we thought of the text amendment would be to just allow it village-wide.
My concern would be, particularly because this is floodplain, that the hollow concrete block would absorb water, and then naturally would freeze during the wintertime, and if it had enough moisture in it, it would start spalling and cracking. I do have a neighbor whose house is cast out of concrete that for many, many years people thought was actual brick, but it wasn't CMU size imprints. It was a smaller brick imprints in the concrete, and it looks rather presentable and everything, and that makes a nice solid concrete foundation, which I think would be more resistive to flooding and problems down the road.
So FEMA does allow this as a flood-resistant construction. It is concrete block. I do know that there are applications they can do to reduce the porousness of the material. It is something the architect wants to be allowed as an option because of site constraints. We have to work within existing lots. We have adjacent houses. We have existing driveways. If we damage the driveway, the village then has to repair it as part of the grant. So we're just trying to reduce our impact to the landscaping and generally the foundation, and not having to drive concrete trucks backing them up and having to pour concrete walls. This allows easier construction. These homes are going to be jacked up on cribbing, and so someone's got to get in there and create this foundation. It's not like we're pouring a new house and there's nothing there that's conflicting with our access. So the architect is just asking, as this is an option for him.
Is the village responsible for the construction that goes on?
Yes. We chose, the way we started this grant process was the village would be the applicant and be the construction manager, more or less, and we're taking over the construction. So we have to have some agreements in place between us and the homeowner and different contractors, especially the elevation company. I tried to research this 3 years ago, and unfortunately there wasn't a lot in the Midwest that had been done via grant. And now that I've discussed this with some other communities further afield, I found there were different options for how to do this. For example, the state of New Jersey handled it differently after Sandy, but they did it's a statewide grant program, and the homeowners applied to the state for funding. Other communities have done it that way as well, but in talking to them, I've also found out that you have one homeowner who's somewhat educated in construction and they know how to coordinate different contractors, and then you have another homeowner who's completely clueless and wants to use his brother Bobby to do the work, and no, you have to get three bids and you have to use the lowest bidder, and you know, it gets very complicated. They don't keep track of records, they don't keep their finances, and so there's pros and cons to whichever way you chose to handle the grant. The way we're proceeding is we are hiring an architect. The architect will design the foundations, and then we will do a bid for the actual construction.
So prior to this point, how many homes have we poured foundations for them?
We've not done anything yet.
So these are the very first ones?
These are the only five. We're doing five homes. That's the village's grant application for elevations, and that's it. And the architect wants this as an option, especially in the sites where the site constraints are tight. Many of the homes in that area do have cinder block foundations, so it would not be out of character in that neighborhood.
Can you see the cinder block?
Sure. They're elevated.
Oh, so it's not covered over with the siding or anything like
nope.
that?
Nope. And they're an older split face type. Block construction.
Is it similar to one of those that's up there, or?
I mean, I guess it would be similar to the one on the bottom. They're white generally, and it's it's the old block. You know, the old blocks that you familiar with.
Do they typically paint them, or do they just leave them that color?
I think they've been painted white for the most part. the few I've looked at.
Is now the appropriate time to, we changed our code, was it 4 years ago now, quite significantly, when Avante was built, from a commercial, you know, residential perspective. I've always wondered if we should bring in the Masonry Council, or the Bricklayers Union, or whatever you want to call it, to have a conversation of where they're at now, the types of construction, and be educated from the very beginning on commercial, residential, and retrofits all at the same time to understand what this is all about. Because I've talked to different contractors, and the Avante or the one across the street, is that, you know, the best construction? Is it the cheapest? Supposedly it was the cheapest. Supposedly it's not the cheapest anymore. And I know that the Masonry Council or whatever it would be just one source, but do we want the board to be educated on what we, you know?
I think that's a great idea, because I don't know of all the options that are all available. In 72, they were limited, and today, with construction and the innovations in construction, I think that wouldn't be a bad thing to learn more about.
I mean, I know
all the options.
From a code perspective, we kept on going after the national code, the national code, the national code. I mean, right now, the two main products going on residential are, was it the LP and the Hardy board? I'm just using two regular names. What's the difference? I mean, you know, should we have both of those? They're both fine products, don't get me wrong, but do we need to be educated a little bit more on what this is all about?
Do we know what the purpose of the 71 or whatever it was?
I'm sorry, what?
Do we know what the purpose was of the 1971 or?
No, the meeting minutes didn't really provide any detail, just approved an ordinance. So unfortunately, I don't know what the rationale behind it was, no.
I can't speak to the mayor's concern. I mean, I don't have the knowledge to speak to the mayor's concern about porousness, but certainly from an aesthetic standpoint, I find everything that's presented here very pleasing and appropriate to Lisle neighborhoods. I think it's attractive, certainly more attractive than poured.
Yeah, as far as the grant is concerned, I don't have the leisure of time, so if the decision isn't to proceed with allowing this, then I have to tell the architect, because at this point, you know, within the next month, he's going to be starting design, and so it will be too late.
I'd have to say I'm supportive of this.
And I think in that neighborhood down Burlington, there's some homes with even stone foundations through the year, so it's not out of character. I just think until we get more information, maybe we'd be better off with a variance for those five to get things going, and then pursue a change in the building code to be more consistent.
Okay.
Would be maybe my thought.
Sure.
But if we can now that it's surfaced that we have this prohibition, but we don't have knowledge about what the prohibition was based on, I would want to know. I would want a concrete, no pun intended, rationale for keeping it, the restriction.
I think the same thing, Kathy.
Yeah.
We don't have the knowledge. Let's get the knowledge.
Yeah.
And I think possibly going back architecturally, there might have been a desire back when concrete blocks were a single uniform look, and they were often filler blocks, they were the structural part of a building, that we may not have wanted that exposed. We would prefer to have face brick on the outside for the exterior and not concrete block like you'd see a gymnasium or a commercial building or anything like that. So maybe that was part of the requirement to prohibit the exposed surface being the concrete block. But with new looks to them, new possibilities, I think it's due for review.
So even with these five, if we have just these five as an exception, would we want to say that it has to be a decorative, that it can't look like a, like you said, an industrial?
I think that could probably be part of the variance.
They're proposing a decorative type face anyway, so.
What's the cost difference between doing this and the siding? And he was saying, you were saying that the architect,
so,
the reason and the rationale was.
So under, it's not siding, it's the issue of poured concrete versus concrete block. So poured concrete, you of course have to get a concrete truck in there, do the forms, fit that all under the crib, you know,
they're
the house is elevated.
They're going to have to do that anyway, though.
But if the concrete block, they bring in the blocks.
No, they're going to have to pour below.
They're at the pour footing, they're going to have to deliver the block.
Yeah, so to
I'm
say that that's not part of it.
I'm just going by what the architect
says. I'm just saying that that's how it's done. They're going to have a truck in there pouring concrete.
Okay, for so. The unless they're able to use the existing foundation.
That's a different story.
Which we have to expose the existing foundations. We're not certain what we're what they are until we expose them.
Have they investigated whether they can pump the concrete into the forms?
No, we haven't let a contract with them yet, so we have to still.
It may be.
They
easier,
want it
cheaper,
as an
faster.
Option.
Sure.
They want this as an option. They have not designed it yet. We have not contracted with them yet. I pointed this out as being a potential issue. If they pour concrete wall, it will be a solid concrete wall. The grant will not pay to camouflage it, decorate it in any way. Siding
That's
cannot be brought
than
down.
Saying
right. So
it's going to ruin sidewalks and stuff.
So what they expressed to me, or what we discussed at our rough design discussions, is they would prefer not to do wood and siding, which is one option, or they would do the concrete, poured concrete wall, but then we cannot do anything to alter it. It would just be a solid concrete wall, which is allowed in our code. I think this decorative block is more attractive, and the architect would prefer this.
I think it's far and away more attractive.
Will they allow the expense of the custom forms?
I don't.
On the outside? The brick looking concrete forms?
No, they will pay for nothing to alter.
It'll just be the plain concrete.
It would have to be plain concrete. So I think this is a more attractive option. We can process variances as they go through the design. We may end up coming for a variance, though, for all five, just because by the time we don't want to hold up the design process by going through a variance.
And I also certainly wouldn't want anyone, like one person gets the variance and four don't, or any mixture of that.
Yeah. So we probably will just request it for these five structures, and once the architect makes his final decision on the design, we'll know which ones have to.
Will that decorative brick extend below grade, or will it be a flat brick below grade with?
I don't know.
Okay.
I assume it would not extend below. I would assume they'd pour a foundation at least 6 inches above grade, and then this would be the elevated portion of the foundation.
The architect will look at pricing options, or he's just designing what he wants to design, and we get one option from the architect?
They would look at pricing. We have a limit to what we can spend on each house based on our grant application. So he knows he's got a set amount of dollars he's working with for his design and construction.
I'm just trying to weigh in my mind that masonry is very labor intensive. Concrete nowadays may be cheaper to put the forms up and pour the concrete if they're already pouring partway.
Again, that's not my forte. I'm going to trust the architect. That's why we're going to hire a professional architect, so they can give us the design.
I wonder if there's a tip-up option or something, where if they can stand a 3-foot piece of precast concrete up on four sides. They do ball fields, shelters at ball fields nowadays that way. That may be cheaper, quicker, faster. But again, getting it to the site may be the limit. But I think in this regard, the variance for these five would be the...
And the architect is conscious, these have to be low-bid jobs. When we put this out to bid, it's a government contract. We have to pick the low bid.
But there's the prevailing wage.
Right, but I, you know, different techniques may require different specialties, and the architect has to also determine whether he's comfortable sending certain designs out for low bid. I'm leaving that to them to decide what they feel is the best fit for each house and what they feel contractors can achieve with success.
Okay. So we all agree on a variance for these? Go that route? Okay.
But then are we going to have as an action step that we'll revisit whether we want to consider a text amendment going forward?
Yeah. Next item is fiscal year 17-18 mid-year budget review and 2017 property tax levy.
Sure. Thank you, Mayor. Good evening, everybody. This evening, staff has set out an agenda for a recap of where we're at mid-year, as well as to review the board's options for the 2017 property tax levy. Just by way of steps and organization for tonight, staff would like to provide a quick recap as how we ended the last fiscal year, 16-17, provide the board a mid-year budget report, where we stand right now revenue and expenditure-wise, highlight some remaining capital items budgeted for this fiscal year, and then talk a little bit about some deferral requests either into the next budget year or as part of the upcoming fiscal year budget document presentation discussion with the board. The other thing that we'd like to highlight as well are some items that we've forecasted that are going to not only affect next fiscal year but also future fiscal years. And then finally recap the options that were presented at the last board meeting for the 2017 property tax levy. So with that, I'll turn it over to Finance Director Schiller to provide a quick recap of how we ended last fiscal year.
Thank you. Before you have two documents. One is the general fund reserve calculation. We do this every year to make sure that we have our six-month reserve per our fund balance policy that was approved August 12, 2012. And part of that policy indicates if there is anything, an available surplus, after we factor in what's needed for the current year, those surplus funds, per the policy, Section A, it says that they would be transferred to capital projects and special revenue funds through the budget process. So we've been doing this every year, and we have been transferring any of the excess reserves to our capital projects, or we've done to insurance fund before, one of our internal service fund. So we have done that through the years to shore up for some of our major projects and things like that. So it's usually covered in the draft one that we submit to the board, or draft two, whichever is the board's first view of the budget. And you'll see it in the interfund transfers as far as that. So we've calculated that this year we have $1.9 million to move to our capital projects funds or insurance or one of the other special revenue funds that we have, or you would have to deviate from the policy, I guess, and designate some other location to put this money. So if you see at the top of the list, we ended up with $923,000 revenue over expenditures on a cash basis, which we do budget on a cash basis, not an accrual basis, which is all different from our financial reporting. We are in compliance, and that is on a modified or on accrual basis, so we're fine with that, but budgeting is cash, which was a board decision years ago. So, but doing the calculation out, we have the 1.9 million. So we will, unless we hear something different from the board, we will be implementing or putting that into our budgeting process and putting that towards the projects that we have laid out. Okay. Any questions?
I have a question.
Okay.
Sorry. So the fund balance that we're looking at on your spreadsheet here, for it's April 30th. So that 10,786, that was the balance amount as of that date.
Right. That was part of, included in the financial position report for.
Right. Do we have a current amount, or are we working with that one?
We work with that one, and that's how we've budgeted. I know we just have September's done today. I didn't look at it yet,
okay.
So I'm not sure where we okay. are today. But yes, we do budget with April 30th. So that's how we do it with all of our funds.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
This is above and beyond what we have budgeted for the new budget, correct?
Yes. We have included the number that's the second line from the bottom. That's what we have in the appropriated fund balance for the current year. For the general fund.
So in my mind, the question then is, do we bank this money and save it for something that comes up, or do we pay down something that's accruing a higher interest rate? I.e., do we put this towards the police pension fund that's that could help us out? That's what I'd like to see with the presentation we had last week about the contributions that could keep that negative growth down. Anyone have any thoughts on that?
I certainly am in favor of increasing the contribution to the pension fund.
I think we need to get out of that negative amortization.
I'm in favor of that as well. I also think, though, that this money that should be placed for capital projects as well. Maybe if you can give a little history of the past, how we, with our capital projects, and we've extended years of street repairs, and I know at least where in my neighborhood where I live and other neighborhoods in the village, there's a lot of streets that need to be repaired that have been delayed in being fixed, and we extended, I think, for several years the projects of street maintenance and repair from prior years. So I think we need to take a look at that as well as taking a look at increasing the levy, at least by the CPI. As I understand it, that amount will give us what the actuary recommended, or at least pretty close to what the actuary recommended for what we need to increase for the police pensions. I think, as I understand it, it's $113,000 extra revenue, and the actuary recommended $150,000. Is that correct?
The actuarial valuation was 1.468, I think. The 150 is to eliminate the negative amortization for this year. That's just for this year that calculation is. So it's a calculation of the interest less how much she was recommending to go towards that interest, and that's $150,000 and change dollar difference.
So if we were to increase the levy by the CPI, would it be less than that? It'd be less than what they're recommending. As I understand it, $113,000 for that?
The $113,000 is the projected increase in the levy based on the 2.1 CPI plus the new construction component. What the police pension itself, just the regular recommended contribution that was requested by the pension board and recommended by the actuary, the 1.46, I think, is like $90,000 higher than it was last year. So of that $113,000, $90,000 was going towards the police pension additional. And then if you put that $150,000 on top of that, then that's that much more. So it's over what the increase in the CPI, if that's what you're asking.
But I think last meeting we heard that we could do that within next year's budget already. That was one of the options, that we could cover that negative amortization and still hold the levy flat. This is additional money that we've saved from this year alone. I'd have a question to Jason. How many, do we have any projects that are shovel ready to go, or would it take us another budget year to get some road repairs and things going?
Well, I think what Trustee Carballo is referring to in terms of capital spending on streets is, years ago we had a policy of resurfacing a street or redoing a street once every 15 years. Due to budgetary issues, that time frame has crept up to now into the once every 17 year time frame. So to get that back on track, I think Trustee Carballo is suggesting we fund more into the capital to get that return back to a 15 year basis. I don't remember offhand, I'd have to look it up to see. I want to say, now with that, we don't just resurface the streets every 15 years if they're in good shape. So we also do a rating component of it, so that goes into the equation as well. So basically, we last year at the analysis, to bring the streets up that were less than a fair condition, it would have required an additional $280,000 over a five-year period to get all our streets above that fair condition. So it's not a relatively large amount of funding, given that we're around $1.5 million a year for street construction. But that's just the street component of it. We've got other projects in the capital plan that aren't shovel ready per se. We do have some additional grant funded roadway projects that are on top of our annual street program now, that we will have our share of construction to fund in that. That's over and above what we've typically done. So there's probably close to an additional $1 million worth of funding for our share of those projects in the next 3 to 4 years that we'll need to come up with. So there are other capital needs too as well.
What about the repairs at the public works facility? I know you've talked about that in the past, and it sounds like
there's some information I think in the packet too on that, but basically we're looking at the viability of doing a major renovation out at Public Works or a new facility out at Public Works versus doing some renovations to keep us in a solid workplace environment, I guess, for lack of a better term. We've got a number of issues out there that are going to take significant dollars over the next 5 years to address, one being our fuel dispensers, our fuel pumps. We've got some old and outdated men's locker room that needs renovating. We don't have a women's locker room. We don't have a female locker room at Public Works. They have a lot of ADA issues. Our locker room's up on the second floor. We have no elevator. There's no way to get to it other than climbing stairs. Things like not having air conditioning in the fleet services area. So they're out there in 100 degree days in the summer working on cars all day. And we have some security issues just with how the campus, I'll call it, is laid out. So the question that will come up is, do we want to spend, I think, just roughly close to, $500,000 over the next 5 years in quote unquote improvements over at Public Works, and still have some of the bigger site issues or ADA issues or security type things that really can't be solved with our our improvements, or do we take that money and invest it into a major renovation or a major addition or a brand new building at that facility? But those run anywhere from the range of $9 to $16 million. So those are really big ticket items versus a half a million in the next 5 years and then onward. So, you know, when you're talking about 1.9 million, you know, that's a lot of money. It's not a lot of money if you compare it to 9 to 16 million for a new public works facility. You know, so there's some decisions that are going to need to be made here in the future, because these items that are I'm talking about are ones that we really can't put off much longer in terms of some of the renovations that are needed. So that's kind of where, you know, brief overview of where we're at facility and capital wise.
So in addition to what you just mentioned as far as the costs, if we were to freeze or not increase the levy by at least by the CPI, we would be, in addition to that, we would be in the next year also increasing costs, for example, for the police salaries. We just approved a contract with the police. That's increasing costs for the police salaries. And then we still need to fund the pension, the police pension, during the next year, which they're recommending that we put in our $150,000 into that, according to what I think the actuary said. So our costs are continuing to go up next year. But if we were to only increase the levy to the CPI, we would basically only be gaining $113,000, as I understand it, which would help with, like, police increased salaries and costs, but at the same time not take away money from our capital costs, our capital improvements that we need to make for the village. Is that correct?
Yes.
So what are the other implications if we were not to increase the levy by at least by the CPI? What other implications will we have with our increasing costs for the village?
Well, considering that we're tax capped, if we don't increase this year, we won't be able to, we'll lose that ability to increase in the future for that. You know, like next year, we could only do whatever the CPI is over the highest levy in the last 3 years, which would have been, well, this year and last year would have been, if we don't increase it at all, would be the same. So we would only be able to calculate on that. We wouldn't be able to calculate on what's projected to be a 2.3% increase, taking into consideration the new construction number. And that's why it's a little higher than the 2.1. You would lose that increase next year.
Are we able to go back, I believe it's 3 years?
Right.
And catch up, not catch up on what we missed in a given year, but raise the rate if needed up to 3 years in the future?
You go by the highest levy in the last 3 years. So you could increase it next year, but you would have lost the 2.1 for this year. You know what I mean? Let's say it's 1% next year. You can only do 1% of the highest levy in the last 3 years, which if we left it the same as last year, would be this year, and last year would be the same. So that's going to be your highest levy. So it'd be 1% on that, plus any new construction component. You wouldn't have 1% on the 2.1% higher. You know what I mean?
Yeah, you lose that compounding.
Right.
But I think with what we've got and the programs that were discussed here, if we spent $250,000 on streets and we spent $250,000 towards public works for not for interim repairs and things like that, not rebuilding, we'd still have over $1 million and be able to put in $300,000 into the police pension just based on last year's, on this current budget. we'd have $1.1 million remaining, and that wouldn't even affect next year's budget. We'd still be able to keep it flat, and we'd still have the police pension budgeted in there at $150,000. So I think we have a lot of opportunity.
When you said 300, is that including that 150?
Well, that's just out of the $1.9 million out of here.
Right.
Still be able to bank 1.1.
Okay.
And put $300,000 in the police pension and still not even touch the $150,000 that we budgeted in the 18 budget. And be able to pay down that, eliminate that negative amortization and get ourselves ahead for the future. I think that'd be the responsible way to approach that.
Okay.
The money though that you take from the budget to put into police pension, that takes away though the money from our capital projects that we need to make for the village, correct?
Are you talking in the tax levy or this?
No, I'm just talking if we did not increase the levy, the implication would be that we would be taking money from our capital improvement projects fund, from our capital funds, in order to pay for what's needed in our police pension funds and our increased salaries for police officers, that kind of thing. Is that correct?
Well, the tax levy doesn't go towards capital projects. It goes towards police services, IMRF, Social Security, or FICA, and the liability insurance, crossing guards, and the police pension.
Right.
So it doesn't go, the tax levy doesn't go to capital projects.
But by not increasing the levy, we're taking money though, in order to accommodate for these other costs, we're taking money away from our capital improvement projects. Like if we needed to make improvements to the buildings, the public works buildings, if we need to improve the downtown, you know, as we're going to need to make some capital improvements downtown with the construction of the Marquette project and the other buildings that are going to be coming towards Main Street, that money would be in our capital funds, but would be taken out of our capital funds to fund the police pensions and salaries, et cetera.
What capital projects will we have to improve on Main Street for Marquette?
Well, we're going to have a lot of work downtown that is going to be, our downtown improvements that were made several years ago are going to need to be updated with the construction, Marquette construction and the downtown construction that's going to take place on Main and Ogden. So we're going to need a lot more capital improvements to be made in the downtown area as well as in other areas of Lyle. And this money, as I understand it, if we freeze the levy, that money you can't get back. Is that correct?
You can get it back.
Huh?
You can get it back.
You can't. If you don't increase the levy, if you freeze the levy, that money that you lose, you never get back. Is that correct?
You don't have the ability to compound, I'll say, on that increase that we would be foregoing this year. That's correct.
I think if we have a capital project, though, that's worthy of that, we could always put it to a referendum and ask for that money that's required for that capital project. Right now, we don't have the capital projects budgeted in our budget, so we're not taking any money away from capital. This just goes towards capital because it's extra money.
Well, we have a lot of capital projects we've been holding off on because of past years we've extended our time. We're going to need to make a lot of capital. I know from Green Trails alone, the streets are in bad shape. It needs repairs. New Albany Road has got a lot of potholes on it, so there's a need for repairs. We've been holding off on projects that really need to be done. And we've heard about the building that needs repairs, that needs updating. So there's a lot of things that we need to do that.
So what we should do is budget for those.
Well, that's what we're here for, to budget for those. Yes. And I think we need to do that.
But as far as the levy is concerned, I think that, you know, the fiscally responsible thing to do is to increase the levy by the CPI and to take those funds, at least take the funds that we would get to put it towards the police pension and not take money away from our capital improvements. Those are not only for improvements that need to be made, but also now, but need to be made in the future. And I don't think we should take money out of our capital improvements funds.
Kim, what is the current amount in the capital fund? Do we know what that amount is?
I don't have that total with me. We have, in the budget, we have appropriated fund balance. Now, we have several capital funds, let's put it that way. In 04, we have 5.5 in appropriated fund balance. And 15 is another one, is our capital equipment replacement. We have 2.1. And 34, we have 4.1, which is our street rehabilitation. 10, sorry. Stormwater is 2.9. Those are the appropriated fund balances from this current budget year.
So, Tony, I think if we need $250,000 worth of repairs that we can identify, and we have $4 million in that budget?
In
the streets
street?
Budget? I think it's an issue of just identifying it and budgeting for it. The money's there.
Well, we're going to need a lot more, though, too, down the road. I think it's good to keep our capital improvement funds in a fiscally responsible manner so that we are able to do these projects down the road. We also need to account for what can happen with other monies that the village might get or not get, whether it's in sales tax, other things. So we need to keep our funds in a position where we're maintaining fiscal responsibility for them. And as the actuary had indicated at the last meeting, the police pension is in need of additional funding. And by increasing the levy just by the CPI, that would allow us to take those funds, put a little bit of funds, instead of taking a lot more funds out of our capital improvements funds, to put that towards the pension funding. That's what I think is the prudent thing to do. I don't know, what do you think about that, Kim?
Well, as I said before, and once you lose that 2.1, we lose it. We lose that ability to increase on that in the future. You know, we've given you alternatives. We can make it work. We'll have to cut certain things or adjust years and things like that. But, you know, we'll make it work. It's $113,000. I guess, I hate to say it, it's not a huge amount of money that's going to make or break a lot of these projects. But again, we don't know what the future is going to bring. So, you know, that's the part that concerns me is, you know, we're trying to look at the future. We don't know. We've been having all these threats from the state and what's going to happen. We don't know what the economy is. I mean, it seems to be getting better, but the bottom fell out back in 2008, 2009, where we had to dip into our reserves, down to 4 months from six, which is why we have it. But, you know, and we were able to, that was our priority, was to get it back up to six, which was what we have. So, you know, we don't know what the future's going to bring. You know, I understand the whole increase in property taxes, and, you know, we're 6% of the bill, so it's not a huge increase for people from the village, but I get it. You know, we're one entity out of, you know, all of the entities on your tax bill. I see it on my own. I get it. So,
and we're not the same. I know the library district just I think froze their levy this year.
They're actually going for an 11% cut.
So, but we're not, we are not the the library district. You know, we have to make sure that the roads are repaired. We have to make sure that, you know, public safety, that our police are properly funded and staffed, and that their pensions are protected. So, you know, it's, I think it's one thing for the library district to do what they did, but we're still, you know, we're only 6% of a property tax bill, and we're funding, you know, police, we're funding insurance, we're funding police pensions, you know, road repairs and things. We can't do things like the library. We have to do things considering that we're getting basically the same amount as the park district, the library, but we have a lot more. We have a lot more to pay for. You know, we have to make sure that our police are, you know, we just raised the salaries for the police significantly, and we have a pension issue that we have to address. So, you know, it's one thing for the park, for the library district to be able to do something that's going to hopefully save some tax money, but I don't think we're in a position as the village to do that at this time. And it's only $113,000, but that $113,000 does help the police pensions. The other thing is, I don't know if the other taxing bodies have addressed this yet, but as my understanding is, the fire department, fire district, is going to be increasing the levy. The other thing that they're doing, though, is decreasing services. We're not decreasing services. In fact, we've increased services over time. We've been very fiscally responsible over the time, the last many years, even before we were on the board, you know, from prior boards. In the past, we've been very fiscally responsible and prudent in saving money and making sure that those reserves are there. So I think we need to continue that. But at the same time, the fire district, for example, my understanding is they're increasing the levy by the CPI. They also have increased costs, though, too, like we do, like the village does. They're unlike the library district, but at the same time, they're also decreasing services. We heard at the last meeting that the fire district is, you know, decreasing services, and we're actually picking up services that they were, you know, they were doing in the past. So I don't know what the park district is doing, but I, you know, I know their prior budgets, and I would be surprised if they're doing anything other than increasing the levy by the CPI. So if anyone, I don't know if anyone knows about what they're doing or what the school districts are doing.
Let me interrupt you just a second, Trustee Carvalho, because I think there's two questions here, and you seem to be answering the question about how to handle the levy. I think before that, the bigger question is, what do we do with this year's excess, and how do we handle that, and then we figure out what to do with the levy afterwards?
Well, this year I think that what was explained earlier is that any excess goes in the capital improvement
typically
fund, correct? That's the way it's always worked, and that's the prudent thing to do, because we actually have more capital improvement projects to do than we have the funds for. So by putting that into the fund, the prudent thing is that we have money available for the future to do these kinds of repairs that need to be made. You know, we heard about the building that needs to be either repaired or replaced. We heard about the roads in our town that need to be repaired or replaced. There's other things that need to be done that, although we don't spend it, we put it back into the fund. We need to have that available for when we need to do these projects. So it's not like we're unnecessarily spending money. We're just reserving money for what we need to do down the road and protecting the village for the future, and at the same time, maintaining our pension funds in a better position than probably any other village or municipality in the state of Illinois. So, you know, I think we need to continue to maintain this fiscal responsibility to do that. By this is money you don't get back, as they were saying, you don't get it back, and it's something that is going to help our pension fund if we do do it. That's, you know.
Well, you're talking about the levy again.
Yeah,
I'm talking about the excess that we have from this year.
I'm talking about not taking money out of our capital funds.
We haven't taken a single dollar out of capital funds. We've got excess money that we could either put into capital funds because it's excess, or we can abate it, or we can rebate it back to the taxpayer.
I think these discussions we always have to put the topic on the table about flood management, the big, and we're inhibited by not knowing the results of this study yet, but that's something that is ever present in our consideration.
That's a very good point too. You know, we have to deal with that. I think that's the prudent way to handle this. So, you know, it's they say, you know, saving for a rainy day, and that's exactly, you know, one of the issues here, you know, as far as the funds are concerned. And I think we've always been very fiscally responsible in the village, you know, long before all of us came on the board, and I think we need to continue to do that and make sure our pensions are properly funded, make sure that our capital funds, our capital accounts are properly funded, and that we're protected, you know, for our future needs. So,
well, at this point right now, the 17-18 budget, we're just halfway through it, so we'd be making assumptions on what we have. Correct.
Right.
So, all we can do is take this as guidance and continue to do the same thing, and hopefully there's nothing unforeseen that comes up, but I don't know that we have any decisions to make on the 17-18 budget other than reviewing it, correct?
Correct. Well, we have some items that we've included as far as
changes,
projects
or
that are budgeted for this year to see what the board's feeling is on those. And there's a few projects or items that are on the deferred list.
So maybe we should go through those, and that would answer.
We have those to cover yet, too.
Okay. Why don't we get onto those if there's no decisions to be made about the 17-18 budget per se? We could hear about what is pending and then move on to the tax levy.
Okay. Just wanted to let you know, we put in the budget overview document that is flying through your screen there.
Go back.
I just wanted to point it out in case anybody was wondering what each of the different funds are for and what kind of things they covered. There's some historical, you know, in the general fund, there's department totals. There's some historical information on revenues and expenditures on some of the major revenue sources, namely state income tax. So I just wanted to point out, we put that document just for informational. It is in your budget book as well. So just if you want to review that at your leisure, we just wanted to point out that was there.
That was very nice and appreciated. I wanted to ask, the expenditures for the general fund, could we possibly see that at some point broken out by labor and non-labor, see non-labor expenditures separately?
Okay. Yeah, all the labor is pretty much all the 5,100 line items, I think.
But when we see this sort of summary.
Right, if you look at I don't have a page number, but the revenue expenditure summary, this one for the general fund, this personal services, that's.
That's labor.
Labor in the general fund. Now, there are other labor line items all in O2.
So like this?
Mm-hmm.
These line items include both labor.
Right, that's the budget total, right.
Labor and non-labor. This is a nice schedule.
Okay.
And I, for one, I'd appreciate seeing this schedule, just non-labor.
So by department, the labor broken out?
Yeah, like, I'd like, yeah, please.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Any other questions on that? We did also prepare a six-month revenue status and a six-month expenditure status. I know you get the monthly expenditure, you get the revenue monitoring monthly. These are broken down, unlike particularly the expenditure, these are broken down by line item. And I didn't break out the encumbrance this time like we did for the current and like the long-term encumbrances. These are just the encumbrance totals, because line by line, quite frankly, that's pretty labor-intensive to do that. So I did not spend the time to do that, I'm sorry. But I wanted to give you the percentages and that, and I just wanted to highlight make a couple of points on this. For the general fund, if you look at the bottom line, that shows that we're 60.3%. We've received 60.3% of our budgeted revenues, taking out the appropriated fund balance. A couple of things that I just wanted to point out that kind of skews that a little bit is that, number one, the property taxes, if you look at the first line 2, 3, 4, 5, those are the property taxes. We've collected a majority of our property taxes. As you're well aware, you pay the taxes in June and September. We've received both of those bulk payments. We do have a few additional payments. We have a November 1, December, and I think mid-December payments yet, but those are significantly smaller. So we have collected almost 100% of our property taxes. The other thing I wanted to point out, you'll see the sales tax in the general fund is 41.42%, which is less than the 50% we would hope to see. And one reason for that is sales taxes also go to Fund 04 Capital Improvement and Fund 34 Street Improvement. We have funded both of those out of the current year property taxes. So if we take all of our property tax, all three of those line items, and all three of the amounts that we've received, we're actually at 50.48% sales tax, so that makes me feel better. Also, the other thing that might skew that a little bit is the interfund transfers. A majority of those, if not all of them, are done. So those are at 100% in many cases. So I just wanted to point that out. One other quick thing that I wanted to point out is if you look at page 7, the Navistar TIF fund, you'll see it says 698% receipt. We just have to do an accounting between the two line items to break out the surplus, which we'll be doing this month. So you'll see that differently in future year-to-dates when we start getting all the budget documents. So we didn't way over-collect in that line item, I guess I just wanted to point out. We just have to do the journal entry, and we're right on to what we projected that they would be paying. So those are the couple of points that I wanted to make on the revenue side. On the expenditure side, again, things look pretty good for the most part. We have some expenses, again, that are the encumbrances are for the full year, such as the professional services in 0120. That is the encumbrance total is majority of that is Prescient. So we budgeted, or we put the PO out there for the entire year. And incidentally, we pay the village's portion and the school district's portion as one, and then we bill the school district monthly, and which they've been paying us monthly, so for their portion. So that's why you see that large dollar amount or that large percentage budgeted.
Can I ask a question while you're on this page?
Mm-hmm.
So I kind of, you know, went through and I looked at items that were over, say, 65-70%, because you figure we're halfway through the year, we should be around 45-50-60, somewhere in there. So I kind of circled things that were real high. Mm-hmm. And the one item that is extremely high and I'm very concerned about is our legal expenses. We are at 90%, and we still have 6 more months of the year. So that to me is kind of something that I think needs to be addressed within the next 6 months. I don't know if anyone wants to talk about it and if this is the proper place to discuss that, or if that would be just a regular meeting, but I am concerned about that cost, and it seems to be, we see the bills every month and they do seem to be increasing. And I don't know what we can do about that, but it's something that's very concerning to me. I think we need to talk about.
Yeah, we will need to do a budget revision for that, definitely.
Okay, you can, oh, sorry. That was all I had.
Okay.
I just wanted to bring it up since you were on that page.
No.
Okay.
No, that's concerning for us too, obviously. We have
Ansel Glink was, around June, was going to submit a fixed price retainer cost to the board. I haven't seen that yet come from them. Eric, would you?
I will follow back up with Carrie Lynn.
Okay.
Okay. Otherwise, you know, you'll see some that are higher. In many cases, they have to do with the PO that's been entered for the whole year. So, but we'll keep an eye on them, and there's some that we know we'll have to do revisions to. Typically, when we do those revisions, we usually take from another line item unless there's some bona fide reason that we need to increase the bottom line. But we'll address that when we get into the budgeting, the true budgeting process with the draft one, and that we'll do the proposed revised, and we'll point those out. So. But otherwise, I think we're tracking pretty good, and I've pulled out the reserves because we budget for those, we have them earmarked, but obviously we don't spend that money, so it kind of skews things a little bit, so I did take those out. So are there any questions on that other than the points that Trustee Hasse brought up?
With that, I think we'll just go ahead and jump into the remaining capital projects for this fiscal year, and then the items that staff is recommending for deferral. So I'll turn it over to our Public Works Director.
Thanks, Eric. In the packet, there's a memo that was put together by Eric and I that goes over two separate scenarios. One is things that are in the budget, they're currently budgeted in this fiscal year, that we still would like to purchase or continue with, and we just haven't gotten to them yet in the first 6 months of the fiscal year. This is the memo here. I'll go down that real quick. One is the evidence storage shelving in the police department. That's just it's a replacement of that shelving with some new shelves that are movable shelves, so that you can increase the capacity of that room. And the police chief can probably speak to the capacity, but from what I understand, that evidence room is at capacity. There needs to be some more additional shelves in there. That's one. And I guess I can go through all these, and then if you have questions at the end, it's fine.
I was just curious. I'm sure it's fine, but why is shelving that expensive?
Shelving for the police department is done on a state contract. You have to have a specific type of shelving and contract to do that. What we're looking at doing, if you, currently we just have regular shelving that would, is not movable. So you're limited to the actual square footage space that you have to walk to put the shelving. What we're looking at doing is going with a accordion type library style shelving, which you can roll, and it really maximizes the space in the building. We have only a certain amount of square footage, so what we're trying to do is create the most expandable and contractible shelving space that's available. When the building was built 17 years ago, they chose not to purchase that type of shelving, probably to save costing. And we're reaching 17 years later the point where we've reached capacity in the room and we need to begin looking at those options. We've costed out electronic movable and a rolling with your hand, like just a roller. And we sent staff out and they found that the roller one is just as easy as the electric one. And it's significantly cheaper. So it's just we've reached capacity and we're looking at maximizing that square footage that we have in the building.
Sure. The next project is replacement of the rooftop air handlers at the police station. Again, you know, the building is 17 years old. It's just time to start replacing those. It is a big ticket item. We've got $54,600 budgeted for this year, and this is year one of what we look to be a three-year program to replace those air handlers. The next project is, I kind of referenced some of this earlier, at our operations building, we've got some soffit and fascia replacement that needs to be done. It's literally falling off the building. The buildings are from the late 80s. We've got $26,800 budgeted for that work. We're looking to continue that. We're currently in the bid document stage on that project. Village Hall building automation system upgrade, we have $50,000 budgeted. Again, that's to replace the HVAC controls in this building as well as the computer that runs the HVAC system here and then the sensors that are within the duct work and then also some thermostat components too at Village Hall here. And again, it's just useful life and the current system we have is not being supported any longer. We have a Bobcat Toolcat purchase. We've got $75,000 budgeted for replacement of a 2003 John Deere tractor that right now is on its last legs. It's hard to get parts for it right now and it's starting to rust out basically. We use this piece of equipment during wintertime mainly for sidewalk snow removal. What we're looking to do is to replace it with a piece of equipment that we can use year round, which would be this Bobcat, this Toolcat piece of equipment that we can use for sidewalk clearing in the wintertime, but then also use it mainly in forestry. As part of this purchase, it has over 40 different attachments that are available for use. We're looking at purchasing a broom for the snow clearing portion and then also a stump grinder attachment so that we can do in-house stump grinding when we do our tree removals instead of having to have a lag time when we actually grind those stumps to provide better service. Also along the forestry lines, we've got a replacement of our chipper truck. That's the truck that collects the chips that run through the chipper. The current vehicle is a 2001, and this one is, again, we're looking to upgrade it to a larger capacity and actually one with a beefier suspension because even our current chipper truck right now, given the way the chippers are configured, we can't shoot the chips into the truck without half the chips flying over the top of the truck or missing the truck, and so now we're spending a lot of time sweeping and cleaning up. So it will help us be more efficient. We're also looking at a crew cab option with this so that we can bring the entire crew out to the site without having to bring multiple vehicles to a job site at a time and be more efficient that way. So those are, I guess, large ticket items that we're still looking to complete this fiscal year. Does anybody have any questions on any of those?
Is the chipper truck is used for brush pickup, is that right?
It's used for brush pickup, and then it's also used during the year for our tree removals, and tree trimming work.
Thank you.
The second page of that memo has a list of capital projects that are currently budgeted this year that we are looking to to defer for one reason or another this year, just to let you know and see if you have any comments on the projects. The first one on the list, we've got $12,000 budgeted for key control software for all of our facilities to kind of manage and inventory all of our keys. Who has them? What are they used for? Are there spares? And basically manage that. It's over the course of years at our different facilities, keys have just been issued, and it's just a major undertaking to track them all. We've done some additional investigation and found some software that is less than $1,000. So we're going to go with that to start rather than do a huge capital expense for some software. So we're going to try that, see if we can get that to work and meet our needs. So we're looking to defer that $12,000, and most likely we'll be just eliminating it. The second project is the Ogden Avenue street lighting project. We currently have $735,000 budgeted in this year's budget. We had met at a workshop earlier in the year and got some refined costs. We talked about limiting the scope of that lighting to what would be the minimum required by the state. We came up with two options. One is a roadway lighting only, which is approximately $400,000, and one is a roadway option with some pedestrian scale fixtures attached to the pole as well. That's a $478,000 option. So we're recommending to defer that right now, unless anybody has comments on it. In addition to those costs, we would also be, if we did move forward with it, we would need approximately $30,000 for construction engineering on that project. Another project that's in our stormwater fund is the Devon Avenue storm sewer construction. That is one, there's a low-lying area in between three or four homes on Devon Avenue. This is south of Ogden. We've got $225,000 budgeted to do some storm sewer work to try and help out that situation. We're looking to defer that right now because we don't have any plans underway for it yet. And one of the things we have budgeted is a stormwater watershed study. We've got $60,000 budgeted that we need to start working on to really kind of take a look at some smaller scale drainage issues that are within the village, non-levy kind of issues, and really get a good handle on what those are, prioritize them, and come up with some dollars to program for those. So we don't really want to do the Devon storm sewer project one until we've got a good handle on all these other projects. The next three projects that are listed are all capital water main projects. They are needed. It's frankly just a case of not having the time to do the design work on them yet for this fiscal year. So what we're recommending doing is deferring the construction dollars for those projects that are listed, and keep the design dollars that are listed as part of that to just get the design work started. But in reality, if we got the design work started tomorrow, we wouldn't be ready to put shovels in the ground until next fiscal year anyway. So there's really no point in reserving those dollars for the rest of the fiscal year. The next item is asset management software for the Public Works Department. That's $60,000. It's software that it's work order software. It's software we don't have right now. We still do a lot of stuff by Excel spreadsheet. And it makes it challenging sometimes to account for our man hours and our cost of our different programs that we use. This would help us organize our budgets. It would help us organize our workloads and allow us to track the work that we do and provide better reporting. We're recommending deferring that because we've got some we've got to do something with our GIS program here because we had a resignation of our GIS coordinator. So based on what we decide to do with that, we'll look to see how that fits with our asset management software. The last two items are vehicle replacements. Vehicle 801 is a pickup truck that's used by our fleet division. That's $30,000 that was budgeted for replacement, but looking at it, we can defer that for a year. It's still in good enough condition where our fleet manager recommends us deferring that. We don't need to replace it at this point. And the last one is a one-ton dump truck, vehicle 220. We have $70,000 budgeted to replace that this year. But what we're doing with that vehicle is looking to upgrade it to, I guess what I'll call a beefier version of a one-ton pickup truck with some heavier duty suspension and a heavier duty plow, and spending another $20,000 to $25,000, I believe, in that one, rebudgeting it for next year. But the thought being with that is, to use that as potentially as a backup vehicle for one of our large 5-ton plow trucks. So right now we have 8 large 5-ton plow trucks in our fleet. We have 7 snow routes, so we have 1 truck per route plus a spare in case one breaks down. The thought being with this vehicle would be that potentially we could use that as our backup truck, because if they now come with heavier duty packages where it may be able to possibly use it for road plowing instead of just kind of parking lot plowing. And if that's the case, we would be able to use that as our backup vehicle and then not have to purchase an 8th 5-ton.
I have to ask, can we go later with the blue pickup then?
I got a call for that just today.
We can get 5 more of them.
Yes.
Yeah. No, I guess to answer your question.
Yeah, I knew that.
But that would say instead of spending $150,000 in a future year on a replacement truck that is basically a spare, we could potentially use this and spend $25,000 more on it. So we're just, as we get replacements, we kind of look at them and trying to take a fresh look and see if there's ways we can multi-purpose the vehicles or kind of change the way we do things to try and save some money. So that's a listing of what we've got planned for to still do and what we're recommending for deferral for to next year.
Any questions? Jason, none of this is included in what was shown as above our budget.
Right.
This is already included in the...
Right, this was in...
It moved into next year.
Yes.
So does that mean we have extra money then? Is that what
not any extra, but we're moving these projects into next year, right, along with their funds that were budgeted, correct?
Correct.
The last time before we get to the tax levy discussion are a couple additional items that I had put together for mid-year budget considerations yet this fiscal year, as well as some items that staff had identified for future budget years, one of which we already talked about a little bit was a public works facility. So this current fiscal year, as Jason had alluded to, we had a resignation in our one-person GIS shop for another community. We have been looking at alternatives to hiring a full-time employee, one of which was the GIS consortium, which is a regional GIS consortium. Staff is still evaluating that, working with the GIS consortium on that, continuing to do its due diligence and look into that. In the meantime, though, we have an opportunity to partner with DuPage County for some shared services in the meantime to keep us up. They're used to Esri software and how we manage our GIS program currently, so they have provided us a scope of work and a cost which is going to be significantly less than what we had budgeted for in salaries for this fiscal year, so it will be at a savings. So in the next couple board meetings, I'd like to be able to bring the board an IGA with DuPage County for some of that shared service as we continue to work towards evaluating and looking into our membership with the GIS consortium. So unless there's concerns, you'll see that at a future meeting for some shared services. The other item, and perhaps Marilyn may want to touch on this, a couple weeks ago when we did have our significant rainfall and some flooding issues, the overhead sewer rebate program came to the forefront of some in the community. When looking at our program, how it's allocated, there's a 50% cost share of the overhead sewer of the first $2,000. We know that the cost to do this program has increased. At this point, staff is looking for the okay not to increase the budgeted amount, but be able to look at the program guidelines itself and possibly increase that, knowing that we'll have less money to give, but we think it may get more use. And Marilyn, I don't know if you want to add on to that.
So two things. I did bring this to the board a few years ago, and at that time, and there's a memo attached here that shows the breakdown of what adjacent communities are offering. And so I had a resident contact me 2 weeks ago and ask, why does Lyle give so little compared to, and he had done his research and had looked at other communities. And I said, well, I can ask the board again if they would consider increasing it. As of today at 3:30, Eric did not know this, but I did receive a phone call from a resident in a cul-de-sac where all five homes had sanitary backup on October 15th. And they are all planning to apply for this rebate. So I have the potential for six applications this year. And to date, I've had two, I think, in the time I've worked here for 3.5 years. So potentially would have six this year. So I have money for five at $1,000. And so the hope was that we would increase it. These typically run $6,000 for homeowners to do. So that's why many of the residents are asking if we would consider increasing our share. Because, you know, they feel that there's so much inflow coming into the system that's outside of their control, that they can't fix that stormwater inflow into the sanitary system. And this is one way that we can assist them in protecting them. So I don't know if you guys want to discuss increasing it. And again, last year we had no one. The year before, no one applied. 2014, we had one or two applications. So,
do we know how many problem areas there are where this would potentially benefit?
Jason, unfortunately, just walked out of the room. I am the stormwater manager. I don't track the sanitary sewer systems. After storm events, I have spoken with the admin at Public Works, and what seems to happen, unfortunately, is not everyone reports their backups, and I don't know if it's because they don't want it, have to acknowledge it at a future date, so they don't necessarily want it on any paperwork at the village. Yeah, because I'll receive a phone call and then I'll let them know that I received the phone call from someone, and they won't have that address, but they'll tell me other addresses. So there doesn't seem to be, the people don't call the Public Works Department to let them know that they had a sanitary backup after an event consistently.
Could it be they're not aware of the program? Is that possible?
Just more that they don't even call to say, this happened to me. What is the village doing to prevent this from happening?
Is it my understanding that the day after, the sanitary almost basically hit capacity because of storm water in the sanitary system? Did you hear that right from somebody or not?
Well, I know that I received, I spoke to one person along on River Road. He's directly connected to the DuPage County main line, and he had minor backup. So clearly the DuPage County main line that runs down the East Branch was full to capacity. But of course that's the final destination for all the runoff. And I don't know that I want to elaborate on the other neighborhood that was affected.
Should the improvements be made at the beginning of the system or farther down the system where it can handle capacity?
So Lyle, for example, does the lining program every year. We do televise lines. We choose lines where we know that they're having a large number of cracks. Again, Jason would have to talk in more detail about this. And then they select which pipes they're going to do lining on.
If we have a capacity problem, this gets back to Trustee Carballo from a half hour ago. Those are the types of things we probably should be using those types of monies to address.
But we could, we could possibly line more if we had more funds for that. I think the other factor in all this, which points to a lawsuit that I think Farmers Insurance had filed back in 2013 against DuPage County and a bunch of the Chicago area counties, everyone's individual service lines. You know, if someone's had tree roots routed out of their line, that's all locations where water is inflowing. And there was some estimate somewhere that I wanted to say said something like 60% of all stormwater inflow into the sanitary lines happens between the public line and your house. So everyone's individual service lines have cracks, and unless they've been lined, there's inflow.
And that's not part of the village lining program? That's private?
That's the private. Mine's lined. Does anyone here line their sanitary service?
No.
So.
You're a proud mom.
So you gotta line your individual service lines also.
And there's some areas of town that even the overhead sewers are really not a viable option. If you're below elevation, or if you're, like the elevated houses, if your basement is susceptible to frost now.
Well, the elevated houses will not have basements. They will have only.
Will they be able to engineer an overhead sewer in a house like that?
It has to, yeah.
Okay.
They have to have ejector pumps in their first level, which is an area allowed for stormwater or floodwaters to enter.
We wouldn't have sanitary overhead. You're 10 feet in the air.
It just comes down.
It just comes down, but.
And then they have to.
You don't.
Oh, yeah. No ejector.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Only if you have a basement.
I'm not thinking. Yeah, it just flows down by gravity.
But if they're elevated already and they're still below elevation, they may be getting backup from other parts of town if it has nowhere else to go.
If an elevated house has sanitary backup to their floor that's 8 feet above grade, that would mean everyone have fountains in the remaining houses and their toilets and showers. So I guess it's just a decision whether the village wants to consider increasing the rebate. I apologize, I don't have it right in front of me, but I know the other communities have, on average, I want to say $2,000 for their rebates.
Looks like $2,500 up to $4,000.
Yeah.
Neighboring communities. How are you going to handle the fact that you said we have six this year?
I would look at other accounts in stormwater that I'm not going to spend all my funds.
We're not going to turn anybody away.
Well, the overhead sewers is in the sewer fund, O2, which is an enterprise fund. It's not one that we would be transferring capital project money to. It's an enterprise fund, which means it's the revenues in that fund are generated by fees for on your water and sewer bills.
So we wouldn't turn anyone away, I'm assuming.
We have $5,000 budgeted, and I know that we haven't gotten started, and Mike could, sorry to put you on the spot, Mike, but Mike does the water and sewer accounts for budgeting, but we have $5,000 budgeted this year. I know that Jason has submitted in his budget $10,000 for next year for this program, but we have not really even begun the process. There's only $190,000 in reserves in sewer, so it's not like it's flush with money, I guess. So, but just as an FYI,
flush.
Sorry.
I caught it.
We charge $5.60 every 2 months for residential. I mean, it is what it is. So, anyway, but you know, we'll be looking at that going through the budget process. So, I don't want to speak for Mike wants to speak for himself. I don't know.
To raise the sewer rate, totally sufficiently funded. One thing you can do to find people like that flood is get sewer backups, COVID, and exposure. Mm-hmm. It only costs a couple $1,000, like a cost share, whatever. It seemed to me that they have a legitimate right that isn't bad. A sewer backup.
Right.
One surplus in sewer is inadequate.
Right.
Totally inadequate. Speaking as a resident, working on the third year, we did look at a system that was constructed, I think it's 65 or whatever it was, mm-hmm. out of clay pipe. Older houses had clay service lines, a newer one went to PVC. And we joined in a clay pipe. Where roots enter reasonable cost share, because the backups are due to inadequate sizing. People dump their sump pumps in, so they're partially deflated. In various ways to reroute the sump pumps, not outside, and then put sanitary sewers. You have to analyze your monthly bill for your sewer.
I agree.
Because you have 80 miles or whatever of the sewer, you have, what did you say, 200?
190,000 in reserves, you mean?
Yes.
Yeah.
That's it?
Right now, yes. Pardon me?
In the sewer fund?
Yes.
You only have 190,000?
Right.
It's like having a pony, you having $500 in life insurance. I'll put my name in these.
So that could take care of itself within the sewer enterprise.
Right.
Take a look at that whole
right.
business plan. Encourage that the overhead sewers, and maybe encourage lining as well to prevent.
Yeah, I mean the village backflow. Has a lining program.
But on private property, on the private property portion.
Oh, I don't know that we'd ever go
didn't.
Into that.
But no, could we encourage people to look into that themselves?
I could look at
how costly is that, the lining, I know it would depend on footage and everything, but
I mean at some point I'm sure
Carl can
probably speak to this at some point, whether you have to tear out your line and replace it, you know, depending on how much is there and whether they can line it.
It's a 4-inch to begin with, you can't really, isn't it?
They lined mine.
It's like they insert a sleeve and blow it up and it just it's like a bag inside that hardens.
Yeah. But, I mean, I think in general, like the resident pointed out when he was very frustrated, was, you know, Glen Ellen is 2,500, Downers Grove Sanitary District is 3,000, Wheaton is 3,000, Wheaton Sanitary District is 4,000 for how much they'll match. And then the DuPage County will match up to 2,500. Well, it says a total payout of 3,500, so we are substantially less.
Do you think we'd get many more takers if we raise the amount?
You know, every year I will have someone contact me at least once, possibly twice a year, and say, I'm thinking about it, but man, $6,000, and we like to call it flood amnesia, where for every, you know, month you get past a flood, you start convincing yourself it's not going to happen again. It's just, yeah, this is just a one-time thing. It's just not going to happen. So
rainfall.
Yeah. So, you know, if we can have that incentive there, they might go ahead and do it. Instead, I don't hear from them again.
It's had very little usage, quite frankly, in the whole time I've been here. It's been in place, I think, the whole time, right, Carl? And it's a handful, you know. It's got to be less than 10 in 30
Yeah,
years.
And I don't know, you know, I've spoken about this with Justin and Jason, and so I know when they got phone calls from this event, they said, let me let you talk to Marilyn Succo, and she can tell you about our overhead sewer program. So I think some of it's just our staff in Public Works being aware that it was out there and informing someone when they called in.
Do you know how long the rate has been the same? Or the reimbursement?
It's been that way as long as I've been here.
So it's due for an increase in...
I think it was $1,000 when overhead sewers cost $3,000 to $4,000. Now they cost $6,000 and sometimes more. So
I think we probably should look at increasing that.
The whole program altogether?
Well, yeah, considering, like Kim said, what has there been over the past 20-something years?
Yeah.
So minimal.
So it's just kind of something that's there, but really not thought of a whole lot because we haven't had a lot of usage.
Right, but the people that could use it, they're being kind of discouraged. I mean, I wouldn't want to spend $5,000 of my own money to do it. I mean, that's costly. It'd be nice if we can help them out, considering there's not that many people using the program to begin with.
And it's on top of the fact that generally they've just had to tear out all their carpet, tear up a lot of drywall, throw out couches. Yeah, so.
I don't know, it's just one of those would be nice things. Just my thought.
Can we put that on a future workshop to revamp the whole sewer enterprise? The rates and everything and see what we can come up with?
We'll be doing a rate analysis in the next month or so. So yeah, we've had that conversation.
In the meantime, do we want to look at our program and within our current budget, the 5,000, and knowing that we may be able to do fewer projects at this point, just given our limited amount of reserves currently for there? Do we want to look at the program now in order to get the people that were kind of first in the door an option, or do we want to just look at it as part of the budget?
You're speaking of the six applicants right now.
Right, the first couple, we look at the 2,500 or and you know, once that's gone this fiscal year, it's gone, and we'll look at funding in the next budget year.
Can we answer that today, or do we have to have that in an open meeting?
We'd probably have to bring back revised program guidelines to a board meeting to approve, so.
Right, we're just looking for your thoughts and direction on where you want to go with it.
Anyone from the board?
I don't have a strong feeling about it.
Well, if we have money to spend on legal fees, give these guys the sewer backups this year, you know? What is actual, right? You know, just as simple as that.
Different funds.
I understand, but priorities should be no further thing.
We can't make the decision today, so we have to. But we'll certainly take a look at it. I'd like to hear from any other board members on their thoughts, otherwise.
Bring it back at a future board meeting with the recommendation that you can, at that time.
Yeah.
I think so.
Okay.
Sounds good. And that moves us into some future considerations. And again, Jason had to leave. His wife had a vehicle emergency, so he had to step out. So I apologize for that. Just one thing we wanted to put on the board's radar as we head into budget preparation time and looking at our five-year capital budget. The first item that Public Works has identified is a sewer jetter replacement, upwards almost $400,000 for a replacement for the 93 sewer jetter truck that we'll be looking at being proposed in the next fiscal year. We highlighted briefly the Public Works facility, but that needs some additional discussion by the board, that we bring back the new facility study recommendation for the board to take a look at. But again, we just wanted to bring that up and make sure that was on the board's radar as well. The other item staff is looking at putting together as a part of the next fiscal year budget that you'll see is some additional engineering support for both Marilyn on the stormwater side as well as Jason. Back in 2011, when we did our voluntary buyouts and staff reductions, we had lost our civil engineer. And again, why you see a lot of these projects on the deferral list that we just talked about is just a matter of time and being able to get to those. So staff is looking at options, contracting with an engineering firm to provide some additional support, particularly with the capital improvement budget, and giving Jason some support, as well as working with Marilyn on some of the stormwater improvement items that we really need to get to. So that'll be part of the budget submittal moving forward. The other item, our phone system here at Village Hall is currently at end of life, and support will end in 2018. The good news there is, as we are pressing as both IT support for the school district and the village, we're looking at potentially a joint purchase of a new phone system as they look at a replacement phone system for them as well. We are connected via fiber in the iNet, so we hope to be able to get some cost reduction.
What year did we get that
by phone partnering system? With them?
What year did we get that phone system? Because I went through this process once already, and I haven't been here that long.
2011, 2012.
Yeah,
I believe.
What was the total cost, do you remember?
Ballpark of 90. I think we had just did an upgrade to our current NEC system. Between 60 and 90, I believe.
60 and 90 for 2011, so 6 years. And that's how expensive these things
right.
are? Can we buy everybody a cell phone and call it a day?
Was this $180,000 our cost, or is that the total cost, which would then be split between us and the school?
Right now, this is a preliminary budget estimate for us.
Okay.
So, and this would be looking at VoIP-capable system as well. And the other item, looking at existing service and programs, again, talking about a currently underutilized program is our taxi subsidy program that Christine with the business office budgets for. We are looking at some alternatives to that. There is a Ride DuPage program that we have been looking at that would be an alternative to that. Christine, I don't know if you want to talk a little bit more about our current program and utilization and some of your thoughts.
Okay. Well, the current taxi subsidy program was established in 1991. As originally established, program participants can purchase up to $50 in coupons. It was a 75% subsidy. They'd pay $12.50 for $50 worth of coupons every calendar month. In 2010, we made some changes to the program. It became a 50% subsidy, but the $50 maximum remained the same. We also limited people could no longer use these to go to airports or casinos. Once that those changes happened, participation dropped off significantly. I feel like over the last, 7 years, I've seen it just sort of fade away. Right now, we've got 34 so-so active participants. We used to have 149 10 years ago. I feel the biggest reason for that is the $50 limit. You know, $50 doesn't take you that far anymore. And they're paying for half of that. This program saves them $25 a month. One of the alternatives we looked at was Ride DuPage that is administered through the township. The benefit there is there's no limit to the rides. They can as many rides as they want in a 6-county area in northern Illinois. They do, I know for taxis, they're paying about half. I don't know if they, for instance, they also have handicap vans, that kind of thing, which, with our program, you don't really have.
Do they have their own drivers, too?
Possibly.
Okay. A lot of townships do it that way.
It's a combination.
Okay.
They use taxis. They use PACE vans, It's just a combination of things.
The majority of them are private.
Private drivers driving those.
Drivers. Yeah. The majority
right.
of them are.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's very rare that you have these buses come. It used to be years ago, but not so much anymore.
Yeah. It depends on where they're going, what kind of service they need, if they need a wheelchair lift, what exactly they need. While we're not an active participant, Lyle residents can participate in this program. My thinking is if we were to become an active participant, that would help with the long-term viability of the program, ensuring that those subsidy levels stay where they're at and don't creep up. I just feel like our current taxi subsidy program just isn't really feeling a need, or we would have more people signing up and using it consistently. We have a lot of people who sign up, they buy coupons 1 month, and we never see them again.
It's because it's cost prohibitive. That's what I've heard through different sources. The Ride DuPage seems to work better because of the subsidies for a lot of people who are going to doctor visits and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
They're subsidized even further. Uh-huh. So there's almost a 60 to 80%
mm-hmm.
reduction in cost to go
yes.
to the hospital
mm-hmm.
as opposed to going to meet a friend or going to shop.
Right.
So there's a difference between that, and I think that the utilization dropped off because the limitations of subsidy.
Yeah, Ride DuPage is just a much more robust program.
they have a lot more drivers.
Feels greater need.
Yes, and the rider, the drivers are also the key. Is you, the only drawback is that you do need to call them in advance. It's right. Not an emergency situation, or you know, you wake up in the morning and say, "Oh my gosh, I've run out of milk and I can't get to mm-hmm. the store."
Correct. And so. Part of it, we've had a couple participants just in the last less than a year bring their coupons back and say they'd rather use Uber.
Yeah.
So, you know, and Uber's not going to take the coupons.
Right. And more taxi, private travel taxi services that were subsidized through our program.
And the other part of it is PACE. They're, I mean, almost half their budget is ADA, yeah. et cetera. I mean, that's a, mm-hmm. and most people don't realize how big of a budget they have for mm-hmm. that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So my thoughts are that either we change our program to make it more attractive, or maybe we just look at starting active participation in Ride DuPage. You know?
Who administers it then? Is it out of the township offices right here?
Office. Yes, and I don't know how many Lyle residents currently participate. I asked that question a couple of times. He said the way their program is set up, he would have to pull everyone with a 60532 area code and then go through, he said, more than 600 addresses and count be incorporated. And he just didn't seem real anxious to do that.
Do you find it's just the same people that utilize it over and over? Like if we discontinued the program, are they going to be, would they actually switch over, do you think? Or is it, are we getting?
I believe they already use it. A lot of them use both.
Okay. I hate to say we discontinue a service and then someone is stuck. That's the only thing, you know.
Yeah. Well, the thing concerning. Is, they're not really stuck because there's no limits to the rides.
The only thing would be like you have to arrange this one 24 hours.
Anywhere from 24 hours to a week. I think the week may be more for the handicap services.
Okay, so we don't typically see a lot of emergency cases, people using this taxi. Like, you know, I desperately need my, you know, my child is in the hospital. I need to get there right now.
Well, they buy the coupons and then they just arrange their own taxi rides.
Okay.
So
they get pretty robust. I mean, these guys are driving all day, every day, moving people from 7 o'clock in the morning till 3 p.m. It's a lot of the.
Are you
the
talking about the DuPage?
Yeah, or other townships. It's the senior mm-hmm. medical appointments and all of those types of things.
Yeah, so. Ride DuPage runs 24 hours a day.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
I didn't even know that existed. That's amazing.
Yeah.
That's great.
I mean, it would be nice to be able to offer an additional subsidy if we go away with this program, I think, for the residents of Lyle. I think we'd have a lot more participation if we did mm-hmm. a little something more robust than what. In conjunction with Ride DuPage.
In conjunction.
Can we get a summary then of what they have, how the whole program's, just a one pager of how it's set up,
sure.
pricing structure, et cetera. I think that we can go from there.
Compare apples to apples.
Yeah.
And maybe and how I'll try to get a count of Lyle residents who do currently participate.
That'd be great.
And a historical participation, what the trend has been.
Okay.
And the other thing is, I think the cab services that we have contracted with, we went from what, 5 to 2?
We only have 2 licensed cab companies right now.
Right, and so
we used to have 5.
Right. So, and the vouchers are only good for those 2 companies. Correct.
Correct.
So that would be the limitation that I think exists with the services that we have.
I think Uber is cut into the taxi companies.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. And Uber isn't ready to subsidize with the vouchers either, from what I understand.
The only way we can guarantee that they'll take the coupons is through the licensing. And it would be impossible to license Uber.
Right.
Okay, so we'll bring that back as part of the upcoming proposed budget cycle as well. The last two items that I had relate to the hotel motel tax fund, the village's annual Eyes to the Skies contribution, both in in-kind personnel services and firework money donation is outlined here. And I don't, Kim, do you want to talk a little bit about where we that fund is at?
Currently, the hotel motel, that's the 3% portion, we currently have, budgeted about $450,000 in reserves. That's what, for the most part, any of these two items come from. As you're aware, we contribute 80% of that 3% portion of the hotel motel taxes to the LCVB. The other 20% is for various other programs, including to the Eyes to the Skies, our Lights of Lyle, cruise nights, what isn't covered by the special events grant, things like that. So we are dipping into reserves for any of these types of programs, and then also the next one with any of the incentive programs, the restaurant grants, facade grants, things like that. So, you know, keeping that in mind, we're just putting this out here to see if there's anything, once we're starting the budget process here, if there's any changes that you want, that this board would like to make as far as the funding for the Eyes to the Skies, you know, whether it be the fireworks or the staff time. We don't bill them back for the staff time. We cover that. And you'll see in this table for the last 2 years of the event, the costs involved in that. So we would just like to get some direction if there's any changes, or do we budget status quo on these issues, or if you had any changes to make.
So is it required that we give 80% to the LCVB, or is that just, like, how did that number get determined, I guess?
That's the funding agreement that we have with them, and I think we have that through 2019.
Correct.
Is that correct?
Last May, it was a two-year agreement that was entered.
Right.
Okay, so that can't be changed.
Historically
right now.
Been 80%. There were a few years in there when things were, economics were such that the, you know, we saw a sharp decline. They were at 90% for 2 or 3 years, but it's been 80% historically outside of that period.
Okay. And as far as Eyes to the Skies, I'm not saying that we shouldn't pick up any part of the cost, because I love Eyes to the Skies and I don't want to see it go away. I'm just curious, and I don't know if you would have the answer, but the Park District does quite a bit with Eyes to the Skies, and I know they have a lot of their employees working there. Do they get reimbursed for any of their costs that are associated to Eyes to the Skies?
I do not know that.
Is there some way to find that out? I mean, I'm just curious. I mean, I know the money goes to a great cause. I don't want to take away from that at all. And like I said, I don't want to get rid of Eyes to the Skies. I love it. It's a huge part of Lyle, huge. It's one of our biggest festivals, I would say. It's right up there with Lights of Lyle. So I'm just curious. These are things that I've just wondered.
I every year I have a giant circular argument in my head about Eyes to the Skies, because I think it's a great model, because you wouldn't be able to have such a volunteer staffed event without being able to incentivize the volunteers. But I think we all have to be aware too that any savings or anything that the village or anybody else subsidizes, because they're successful and they're profitable, that turns around and goes into these very worthy charitable beneficiaries. And so I always think of the fact that you're taking, in some real practical sense, you're taking taxpayer money, and through this conduit, you're giving it to charitable beneficiaries. as opposed to the taxpayers individually making the decisions on their own what charitable beneficiaries they want to support. I don't have any, I'm not saying that I have, I just go over and over that in my head and not sure what is right on that. Because they come in with these lot, you know, the presentation with the giant checks and giant dollar amounts these last couple of years, and it's great. But I just don't know what the balance is. I don't know. Like I say, I feel in some sense there's this coerced, you're coercing the Village of Lisle taxpayer into being a donor for causes they may or may not support. They have other things they support. I just don't know.
I agree with you, Kathy. It's a tough decision. But on just, you know, they do offer the free admission usually on July 4th or the last day of the festival, you know, for Lisle residents, which I think is nice that they do offer that. But it's a tough balance. It's, yeah.
Well, incidentally, as far as taxpayers, just I guess to remind you, it's the taxpayers that are staying in the hotels, which for the most part is probably not Lisle residents unless, you know, you have a wedding or something there like I do.
Right.
But other than that, you know, it's typically not going to be the Lisle residents. It's going to be outside the area, but.
But it's still a taxpayer.
Correct. Yeah, absolutely.
Those are the numbers from the motel tax fund.
Correct.
Is there anything on top of that?
No, we charge the hotel motel tax fund for all of those. And as far as anything else, I mean,
is there another 30 and police come up from different budget or anything else like that?
All the police that work the event come out of hotel motel. Now, we don't track the time for, you know, for us to cut checks for anything.
It basically is a total budget, though.
This is just for the event itself, not the pre-planning. I know the police department meets, Dave could probably tell me how many meetings they meet. That's not including that.
There's no other funds, though, generally speaking.
Right, that we haven't paid other than their staff time.
Is the straight time portion of police paid for by the village, or is the staffing, the police staffing, just the normal staffing, and they just happen to be at the fest during those days? That's all. They work their straight time hours, then they work full overtime at the festival, and the festival picks up. Okay.
So it's an overtime rate. We don't have staffing that would be working that could cover the event under any circumstances. Have to be additional staffing there. We order everyone in the police department to days off, no time, vacation, anything like that day. It's all people.
Sorry, it's gotten to be such a big event. We have requested other agencies to come and help us this year, and we had a couple of agencies that sent officers on an overtime rate, and then we were invoiced for their time.
And those costs are included in the police salary portion.
That the village picks up.
That we paid for the other communities to have people there.
So that's in
the
we absorbed
it in
that.
Here. Okay. Yeah, we have taken it out of.
I would tell you, moving forward, if the event stays as large as it is, we will be doing the same thing in the next few years. One of the issues is it's such a large event that we frequently hold. So the officers work a 12-hour shift in the daytime. Then if it's reaches capacity, we've actually held them over, so they end up working till 11 o'clock at night, and they've got to be back at 7 o'clock in the morning. So this year what we did is we contracted those additional bodies through other, not contracted them, we requested that other agencies come and help us so that we wouldn't have the fatigue factor for those officers returning to day shift. And that was a little bit controversial even within the police department. Some people want to work that time and they want the money. The flip side of that is we go and help other agencies with their big events also. So, you know, it all kind of goes around. And then instead of somebody working 16 hours in a day, they can work a different overtime shift for another jurisdiction at other times.
We bill them for that.
Yeah, the same model's been happening with when Naperville does their marathon. You're going to see a lot of other events. This is not just us doing this. This is a regional effort to try and increased capacity for jurisdictions during these large events.
Now, I know the festival hires their own security as well.
Yes.
Do they need to take a larger, another look at their security plans and?
I'm not sure I understand what you're asking.
Should they be picking up more of the security portion of it? The police side? Yeah.
That would have to be your decision. I believe they spend more on security than they do on police, because there's a lot more security. That is, security for them includes people that direct traffic out at the different traffic points, at the parking lots. and when you greet people, they're the ones that do the traffic wanding, not traffic wanding, but the metal detectors. They check the bags, do all that kind of stuff. They check, sit around the balloon fields, and they have a lot more access points, and it's mostly to keep people out and to check people coming in.
Are they capable of doing this all themselves, or do they need our police presence in order to make a complete picture?
They would absolutely need police involvement in this for it to be a safe event. You would need a significant armed presence, in my opinion, in this current climate in the country, and so majority of their security is not armed. In fact, we really prefer that we be the armed people for the most part at the event. There's a couple of exceptions.
Is it a worthy point of discussion or consideration to compare this to any other, I mean, this is probably, I'm sure, the far and away the biggest, but like, say, Veggie Fest, which also generates tens of thousands of people, right? Mm-hmm. There's police presence there, right? Mm-hmm. Do they pay for that, or do we subsidize? They pay for that.
We bill them, yes.
And so then what's the difference between an Eyes to the Skies and, say, a Veggie Fest? Is it because that's a private, I mean, they're both private organizations.
There's, from our perspective, it's not a difference per se. It's just, this is historically what we've done and how we've handled it. So, that's why we're asking, is there something that we want to do differently?
So we give like them, I say, some is it a worthwhile, at least, point of discussion to consider equal? Is there a double standard, or are we treating everything equally?
I think the question is warranted and a good topic of discussion to make sure that we understand, because I can tell you I've already gotten a phone call with the new stage that's been renovated at the Park District. I've already gotten a call from an interested party that wants to have an event there. Are we prepared with some type of a security package that we can relay to people as part of their business plan and say, this is what we do for anybody that has this type of an event?
Well, whatever event would come in, we would be able to accommodate one way or the other. We just need the time to plan and do that. I mean, if we can do Eyes to the Sky, there's pretty much no event that our department couldn't handle without reaching out, you know, with just like even Naperville, like I said, when they run the marathon, they have another 100 officers from other jurisdictions come in and help. Ribfest is another big one. We track very carefully how we do our security, and we work with them. We work with DuPage OEM, and there's many other events going on at 4th of July weekend throughout the Chicagoland area, and we're pretty much right in par with how we set up security. Now, the paying for it side of it is beyond my aspect of it, but security-wise, we are very, very, very in tune with what's happening and what the best practice recommendations are for security for these events. And I would tell you that there, especially after what's happened just in the last few months, it's that problem is not going to go away anytime soon. Veggie Fest is a much different event than Eyes to the Sky. So even though it brings in tens of thousands of people, there's no alcohol. It's just a completely different crowd coming in. So there's parking issues and everything.
Is what are they operating it for? What happens with the revenue? You know, where does that go? Is it a private business that's making a profit, or is it like Eyes to the Skies that contributes to, you know, local charities based on the volunteer numbers, I guess.
Is it?
Things like that. I mean, that's the other thing, I think, that what we've looked at or what's been looked at in the past and probably why we haven't been billing them.
Do we know why historically we haven't been? Is it because we're a true partner with them, with where the donations go?
It's been the direction of the board for all these years. We bring it up pretty much every year as to how we want to handle it. I know we had the discussion last year, too, as to how do we want to handle it. And I know there was an issue if they had initially requested additional money for fireworks. Well, we backed off on that. The board had decided to leave it the same. So, I mean, there's nothing etched in stone that I know of that has determined this is how it happens. It's obviously, it's grown. And quite frankly, I know that the police department has trimmed their expenses lately, too. And it depends on how many days it is. And there's a lot of factors that alter the costs from one year to the next. But
see, I think, and I shouldn't wade into this because I don't have documentation of it, but it's my understanding that before the committee was reorganized back in the olden days, the park district did charge for rental of the facility.
Oh, they did.
But I don't think they do anymore.
I think they still do, but it's a minimal amount. It's like $1,500 to rent
the full grounds,
I believe. But I think through the years, the festival's had good times and it's had bad times. It had challenging times. And I think the village has always been there for them, not as a true partner, because we don't get any of the money back for it. We fund it, and then it leaves our hands. It doesn't come back to us. This year, I don't think the whole board's discussed this. We had a discussion about July 4th fireworks for the upcoming year. Because the festival doesn't do it through the 4th. They do it the weekend only, has become their business plan. So now if the board chooses to actually have a 4th of July or a 3rd of July fireworks display, we'll be funding two of them. Something to consider.
It's disappointing not to have fireworks on the 4th, I will say.
Right.
I would say most residents
get the public comment in a second. Go ahead.
If the Eyes of the Skies is going to have fireworks and it's not on the 4th of July, let them pay for it. The village should supply the fireworks for the residents for the 4th of July. It is to celebrate our independence. It's Independence Day, and that's where it originated. They want to change the dates because it's more lucrative. So they're looking at it from a financial aspect, not from a community aspect. And fireworks belong on the 4th, so therefore you can take $10,000 out. They charge, another thing, it's Veggie Fest is free. Free admission. Eyes to the Skies charges. And they charge pretty good. Because I know a lot of people that don't go to it because it is cost prohibitive for a family. My 2 cents on the 4th of July fireworks.
See, I tend to think a community on a 4th of July, they expect a parade and they expect fireworks.
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah. Well, and there again, you've got the ice cream social going on that the village doesn't subsidize that, and that's free.
Parade always used to be on the 4th of July. I have many memories of the parade going through.
Well, it still is.
It is.
Parade is still will be.
Well.
But there won't be anything.
But there's always fireworks at night, too. That was the other thing. It was like, I don't know, it was a full day.
It was a full day.
Yeah,
community.
It was a full day. Yeah.
Lyle.
Well, and then I'm struggling, and I don't know if this is a valid analogy. I'm looking at these two women because they participate in it, too. Take something like the Garden Gate that's put on by a private not-for-profit, and every penny of the revenue goes to a charitable. A private not-for-profit is the conduit for it going to beneficiaries. So I, you know, they're not bellying up to the table for a tax subsidy. I don't know. I just don't know.
If I can make a comment, there's nothing wrong with charging charity, and I volunteer at the charity and I do their books, and this is exactly when we do an event, we expect to pay for certain services, and we're always left, then we distribute it the way we decide. But it's a normal thing to expect to pay for services, not to get them for free. You know, you hire entertainers, wherever, it depends on the event we do, but we pay for everything. It's not like we go and ask, oh, maybe since we are running it in this town, maybe they will pitch in. That's kind of not the norm. So maybe instead of just terminating the whole thing, just phase it out. You know, this year we are taking out the fireworks because we want to do the fireworks for the village. And I don't think we should be paying for it. That's my perspective as a taxpayer. I want to donate to the charity I want, not to fund, as you, Kathy, said, not to funnel it.
I would like to consider being there as a safety net when they have their bad years, and the village fronts some of the abilities for the fest to go on, but when times are good, then we can get something back to bank it for another year, to finance it for another year, something like that. One other thought that I want to make clear to the board is that the festival is operated by Parks, by an independent group, but is for the benefit pretty much of the Park District residents, which is a different boundary than the Village of Lisle, per se. So there is a much larger group of people that this benefits overall. It does draw them into town, brings them in, but the people that get in for free is anyone with a Lisle address. So Four Lakes gets in for free, Steeple Run gets in for free,
Meadows.
The Meadows gets in for free. With the thinking is they're part of the Lisle Park District.
That's a good point.
So just a couple things to be aware of.
Well, maybe kind of springboarding off of that, maybe it could be the same or similar, the same up front. But if there's a profitable year where all that's put back to the charities, maybe some of it would be put back to the funder. You know, a certain, some of that profit share would not all go to the charities. Some of it would go back to sponsors. I don't know.
Maybe the village could get a credit for hours put in to share some of the revenue that comes of the fest, comes back to the village. According to the hours spent, just as every other organization does, maybe something like that.
Well, not every other, or just those partners, just those six partners.
Right. I think there's a couple extras included because some extended their participation to other groups in order to get more participation towards them. So I think there were technically a few more than six, but. But if the village was one of those that whose hours counted towards the festival participation, granted they weren't volunteer hours, they were compensated hours, but that's the village's contribution, that maybe the village would get that portion back. Just a thought.
Yeah, I don't know.
Is this something we have to decide tonight?
I think the budgeted amount is, but...
Not necessarily, but, you know, we're going to be going through the budget process, and I'm just looking for some direction to what to budget in.
Maybe we'd want to have...
On 39, that's all.
Maybe we'd want to have the chairman of the committee in to make their case as part of our discussion.
In another workshop?
Uh-huh. Workshop.
And maybe we take a look at it with all special events all together, and maybe raise the special events budget, but make this a part of it. And see what other events come up as well.
Yeah, because like take cruise nights for an example. I mean, that's a wonderful thing, but why are they kind of singled out to get a subsidy, whereas some of these other very worthy things are not? I look at
some of this as seed money. Like we should get these events seeded And after several years, they should be making their own back, and we can seed new ones.
That's one way to look at it, but something like cruise nights, how are they ever going to get back? They don't charge admission. There are a lot of these things that don't charge admission, that are very, they really enhance the quality of life to have them, but.
They help the restaurants downtown, obviously, helps the chamber. You know, I mean, there's different aspects of cruise nights that it definitely benefits them to have it, and I enjoy it. It's
yes,
mm-hmm. Yeah, it's, you know,
I'm not saying it shouldn't have the
right,
but how do you cherry pick certain
right,
ones?
That's what
that
it feels
do.
Like we're doing. We kind of are. I mean, so that yeah. Hattie, how are you fair to this one? And then it's tough. Just, it's I think it's something that definitely needs to be looked at. I mean, really, all of the special events then.
But I do have to say, I think we got to have fireworks on the 4th of July.
I agree.
Really do.
That's without
agree.
A question.
I agree.
I think a lot of people I know miss it personally.
Yeah.
You know, and yeah. A lot of communities are kind of rethinking that as well because Naperville didn't have fireworks either. They were all encompassing the Rib Fest with them.
Right.
And we kind of, I think that a lot of communities are doing that.
You had to go to Woodridge this year to go
and
see fireworks.
It may be safety issues. It may be cost prohibitive. I don't know the answer. But I know that it was tough to find fireworks on 4th of July this year.
What if at a starting point staff researches how much it would cost for fireworks on the 4th, and then we use that to compare what we're contributing to the Eyes of the Skies, and we start there
that,
as part of the budget process?
Yeah. Also, we need to figure out what the best practices would be for charitable events and how much percentage-wise we would be able to contribute.
We need to sit down with that group and have a conversation.
Definitely.
Yeah, definitely. Absolutely.
I don't think there's anyone around this table who wants to have, you know, come off as being adversarial towards this really wonderful organization.
Right.
We want to be supportive of them.
Right.
Yep.
But the non-4th was a unilateral decision, and I think we're collectively raising our hand on that one. But mm-hmm. Yeah, but let's.
No, I think
let's sit down
making best practice rules or guidelines where charitable events happen may be another alternative to this conversation too, where we take a percentage of how much does it, you know, a veggie fest, how much does that cost us? How much does it cost in general? And then put that into a percentage of how much would the village be able to help with that.
We aren't going to solve this tonight. I'd like to keep on moving if we can.
No,
sorry.
Okay,
but a bigger question is what is the hotel motel fund and what do we want to do with it? Because let's move on to the next point.
Yeah.
You know, with the 40,000 in
restaurant
the grant. Yeah, the restaurant. I mean, it's the same bucket we're talking about. So what do we want to do there?
Honestly, I think we should look at that program too. And I wonder if we can somehow incentivize some of the new businesses that are trying to open up in town. And we have a wonderful new business. You know,
we're out of money.
Right. So that's why I think we need to look at that and see, should it just go to restaurants? Should we increase it? Should we look at, you know, new businesses? And should we limit it to the downtown area, or do we want it to be as we've done now? We've expanded it to all over. We're in Green Trails. We're on Maple. Maybe areas that may not need it as much. I don't know. I'm just thinking we should definitely discuss it. It's some because we go through the fund. The fund is gone basically in a month, 2 months from when it's gone pretty quick.
Would there be a better benefit? I think we've talked about this perspective before. If someone is relying on the grant for a business case, they really don't have a business case. Would they be better served by using that money in a collective advertising perspective? Say the Village of Lisle advertises throughout the year and will add your business as an incentive into 3 or 4 months worth of advertising, and then also get the Village of Lisle's name out there in the media, in marketing. Would that might possibly be a better approach?
It would maybe be a purer use of what, since you're supposed to use it for tourism, promoting the village, it'd be a purer use perhaps of the funds.
Advertising is so splintered these days though too. I think every group coming in would have a different idea of what would be a healthy advertising approach. So they get something for free, but if they don't care about it, you know.
I think we need to look at the fund and how we use it and what the parameters need to be. I think we just need to go back and look at.
And Mark, I like your point. Sorry, Kelly. I like your point. Maybe there would be a benefit to having each individual, they do their own marketing, they do their own outreach to their own customers, but as a condition of the grant, then we ask them to put the Village of Lisle tagline on there, or we have something about come out to the Village of Lisle the last 2 seconds, 5 seconds of advertising, or somewhere on their print media we feature something of the Village of Lisle for that contribution.
We tag to them on how they're going to use that money. So.
Yeah. So, I guess we haven't solved how we budget for it or how much we budget for it, but.
I've sat in a few of the EDC meetings, I think, and Pete would hopefully agree with this, that there is some looking for direction on, they want to know what they should be telling us. So I think we have a very enthusiastic group. I think they want to help drive the equation. But they aren't really, well, if the money's disappeared this year, then what other charges do they have in front of them? So something that's sort of on the side, but closely related.
What is the current balance in the fund?
$450,000.
For the grant program.
Oh, there's $40,000 left.
Okay, that's because...
We have, I think, a $200,000 budget, but that's already spoken for if they all come forward.
Is it 30?
Because we gave... 30,000, okay,
we gave away two.
Oh, that's right, we did give
Red
away
Arrow.
10 already, right.
Red Arrow didn't right. Get approved.
Right. So $30,000 left unspoken for.
Okay, thank you.
Well, I think we keep the same budget, and maybe we can have a further workshop to see if we can come up with a further development of the program and work with the EDC and see if we can revise it from there.
Mm-hmm. I agree.
The last item takes us into the tax levy options. At the last board meeting, Kim presented 6 total options before the board. And Kim, would you just remind everybody what those 6 options were?
Okay. All right. The 6 options. Option 1 is increasing the tax levy extension by the 2.1% tax cap plus the new construction component. We had a little over $2 million. In new construction. Option 2 is keeping the tax levy the same. And option 3 is reducing the tax levy by the TIF surplus that we normally would put to capital projects fund. We would put it, distribute it accordingly to the police services. And option 4 is no increase except for the new construction component, which is just a slight increase of projected to be $9,500. Option 5 is the 2.1% increase with putting all of it, all the extra to the police pension fund plus the additional $150,000. So it's more than the increase going to the police pension fund, in other words. So there is a reduction in what goes to the police services. And option 6 is no increase, but with the additional $150,000 over the 1.4 going to the police pension, which has the most dramatic impact on the amount going to the police department salaries. So I've included in each of these options, I've included amounts as to the increase in the levy or lack thereof, and what kind of impact it would have on existing properties. Again, this is on average and it's projected. We don't calculate the rate at this point. We just provide the county or file with the county what the levy amount is. And again, that's also, they do their calculation, which will get those numbers in March as to what the tentative levy is at that point, and the tentative EAVs also. So, but those are the options I have. And again, we put in what we anticipate under the scenarios, the impact on two different house values, $250,000 and $350,000, what we project to be the impact on those property tax payers. So I've also indicated in each of the three options, or each of the six options, what the impact is on the general fund portion or the police department portion of the levy, since most of the other pieces remain the same except for the last two that have additional funds going to the police pension.
Me personally, seeing what we've seen from our progress for this current budget, where we stand today, I'm almost thinking about option 7, where we could freeze the levy and contribute some of this current budget excess additionally to the police pension fund, as we discussed earlier, and still be able to put a good portion in towards capital, combined with the fact that we're pushing probably a couple million dollars worth of capital projects into the next year already because we can't get them done this year. So I think there's room for even more improvement.
I agree with you.
Anyone else?
I agree with you.
Well, the levy would be the same is one of these options.
Yeah,
technically, the excess that we discussed at the beginning of the meeting is separate from this, and that can be budgeted accordingly. So I guess if you're looking at no increase, then it would be option 2.
Or option 6.
Or option 6 would be no increase.
And the most amount to the police pension fund, but I'd like to put a further amount into the police pension fund, closer to $300,000, and get a little bit more of that principal paid down.
So would you look at $300,000 plus the extra $150,000 in addition to the 90-some thousand more, which is the 1.4 going to police pension, or would you be looking at option 2 with no increase, the 1.4 going as part of the levy, but then an additional $300,000 going as part of the capital, or as part of the excess?
Is the idea behind the number you're picking for the pension, the idea to get it off of the ramp and into a flat?
Yes.
Yeah.
Exactly.
So are you? Can I make a comment? As a taxpayer, idea is very simple. Like for me as a taxpayer, I don't want taxes to be increased. But some numbers that they're looking at makes me very upset when things are brought up that the system upgrade will cost $180,000, or when the office and fascia will cost $30,000. I don't want, and I know how much it costs. So things like that tells me that there's money. by ignoring the repairs, and then now we need a new school because we haven't done any repairs for so many years. So from my perspective, I think not only there should be no increase, we should be starting looking at how to cut our expenses because they are out of the control. Literally. Again, that's my position on it. I hope the board goes with no increase at the very least. But realistically, the expenses should be revisited and tax levy should be cut. Thank you.
Thank you.
So is your thought an additional 450 plus the 1.4? Or is your thought 300 and not 450? Do you know what I mean? Because I see what you're saying with an option 7.
Yeah, I just
that much less going into the general fund, which we could
I think having a frozen levy and instead of 150,741 going to the police pension fund, we raise that to 300 and double that.
Is there a magic number that will actually?
I think basically we're making 2 years worth of contributions to the police pension fund.
That was the amount that the gentleman suggested.
Actuarial?
It to flatten the contributions versus having them be on that ramp.
Okay, and then of course that's based on the rate of return being hopefully what you would expect.
7%,
it to be.
I think,
right,
is
right,
what
I
they
know.
Based it on.
Okay. Just want to make sure we're hitting that number.
So that would combined with the flat levy would bring it to, I think you said, like $450,000 of the 300 plus the 150 from not getting the levy, right?
Okay.
I thought the amount he said, I thought the 150 was to get out the negative amortization, okay. But that to bring it to flattening the annual contributions, it was somewhere around 350.
He said around 300,
yeah,
I think.
So it's, I'm
and
thinking
he said that's off the top of his head, so.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
I
mean,
know
we,
it's not
we
a fixed,
may
it's not
still
an actual
have even,
dollar amount
even more, and I don't know if we could do that at the end of the year, contribute more of that before turning it into capital, depending on how the year finishes. I mean, granted, we're midway through the year, but I think even in next year's budget, I mean, the budget's the budget. We'd have to, if we're truly taking this out of the budget, you're finding another $150,000 to take out of the budget, correct? As opposed to.
Will it be more of the 1.9 that you're taking the 300 from?
So
it'd be 450-ish.
I think we should strive for that and take what we have at the end of this year instead of just putting it all into a savings account like we would personally, take it and put it into our 401k for our retirement is the way that I'm looking at it.
I appreciate hearing candid feedback from all of you on the employee side as to your thoughts, concerns, or whatever about the different strategies.
Well, as I had indicated before, I listed the pros and cons, I guess, of the issue of tax cap versus flat and all of that before. You know, and I understand as far as putting more to the pension, I mean, we have had we have gone above and beyond, I guess, for years. You know,
but the benchmark is low. You know.
Well, right. But I mean, we have gone for 100% funding. We've tried to do, we've done the entry age normal instead of the projected unit cost, which is backloaded as well. So we have done things that we thought were reasonable without making an exorbitant levy,
yeah.
So to speak. So, you know, keeping that in mind, again, I understand. You know, the from a taxpayer standpoint, I mean, we're all taxpayers, and I understand that. I have to be concerned as far as the future of the village, and I just have to do my job to bring it up. That's the only thing. So can we make it work? Yes, we'll make it work. Maybe we'll regret it in years, possibly. I don't know. But I'm just bringing up all the issues so that it's, you know, an informed decision. So that's my point. Well, you know, we'll go whatever way you want to go. We'll make it work.
Eric, did you want to?
I would concur with Kim in the fact that, you know, whatever the board like to do, we'll make it work. I think being a native of Springfield, I am nervous as to what Springfield may do to us. I think there are some real concerns. I think we're looking down the road, although the property tax freeze for the 2 years has been deferred until the January veto session. I still think we could be looking at that. So I want to just put that out on the table too. That's not off the radar at all yet either. We could be looking at 2017 and potentially 2018 and 2019 as opposed imposed by the state of Illinois. And as Kim had mentioned, you know, we are non-home rule tax capped, and so there are those considerations. There's still a big question mark with what Springfield may do and a potential sweep of local government distributive funds. There is quite a bit of that. But again, you know, staff is ready to make it work, whichever way the board decides to go, and whatever comes, we'll roll with it and make it work.
I don't have anything else. I mean, I agree with Kim and Eric. It's just a, you know, you can't always tell the future, but you do the best you can to plan and prepare.
Anyone else on the board?
Well, I feel strongly about the pension contribution, and I would support going up to the attempt to flatten the ramp.
Do we ask for that to be submitted to the board then?
I think I'm of two minds, because I do understand.
Mike.
I'm of two minds. I do understand what staff is saying about freezing and the fear of what will come of that. But I also feel confident that if we do freeze, it will be, we need to do the contribution to the pension fund either way. And if we freeze and we take on that burden and add to the fund, or we do a levy and we still add on that exponential amount, makes sense. Because my fear is, as we're going through this process, as we get closer to 2040, we're going to have to somehow come up with this big lump sum. And how are we going to get there? Right now, we do have reserves. We don't know what the future will entail. But I really do feel strongly that the more that we can bank into our unfunded funds, the better off we will be for tomorrow and what we leave for our legacy for tomorrow. So at this point, I mean, I fear what's going to happen in Springfield. I do. I think it's a logical fear. It's not illogical, or which wasn't the case 6 months ago. You know, so I think it's something that we all need to, like, really think through and have multiple examples of how are we going to get that underfunded fund to the next level, and how can we maximize that?
And I think we can do it. I know we can do it.
I know we can do it. I just, even if we levy that amount, I would feel more confident if we put it into the pension fund to
do everything we can possibly do to
right
to get the pension
amount
fund paid down
right.
And I think that's where we're going with this
right today, rather than, you know, tomorrow.
Question: the 2.3%, is you could do any, is it true you could do anything up to 2.3 would just be the maximum, but you could.
2.1 is the maximum. The 2.3 is incorporating the new construction.
Okay, okay, so the 2.1, could you do something in between 0 and 2.1?
Sure.
Okay.
And that's what we did last year, is that right?
Well, the CPI changes every year.
Okay.
So it hasn't been 2.1 in a long time.
So you want to maximize on that?
Well, we typically do put in whatever the maximum is, and it changes. Last year, I think it was 0.7 or 8, yeah. I forget now.
But like the eyes of the skies, we've had good years and we've had bad years. We used to give tax abatement checks. I remember you getting those 20 years ago or so. And for a good long period of time, we've taken the maximum allowed. And I think making an effort to freeze it says a lot about what we can accomplish and what we can do, and I know we can do it.
I think we can do it. I think we need to look at some of our expenses. I mean, let's tighten the belt. I mean, everyone's having to do it. It's not just us. And it makes me sad to see so many people in Lisle putting their homes up for sale, because they tell me I can't afford the taxes. And I know it's not just us. It's overall. It's the big picture. It's the schools. It's the library. It's us. It's, you know, it's many different aspects of it. But I think we need to be responsible and do what we can to help our residents out. And we are in good shape. And I think, you know, making a sound decision, I think by freezing and then putting that money into the police pension fund for the future, I think would be a sound decision.
So do we have direction then for next Monday's meeting?
I just want to add, there's a lot of things that have been said here tonight. I agree with what I think the general consensus of the board is. The only thing I ask is, I think we're being very, very responsible, you know, with a new millennial budget and where we're at and where we want to go. Let's just not forget, if we want to make this village the best it can be, that we very, very quickly tabled the $700,000 at the time for the streetlights on Ogden Avenue. Those types of discussions, and we went through it in 2 minutes tonight. I think they're just as important as $113,000 here. I understand it impacts each individual taxpayer, but I think we have to look at all of it, not just, let's just not figure out how to shrink the budget down and make things, not make the village less vibrant on what it's trying to accomplish for all of its citizens. Let's try to look at both sides of the equation.
And I think I agree with you, Mark. I think getting some engineering assistance for Maryland and setting priorities, finding out, setting a cohesive downtown plan and identifying where we're going to get the most of our value.
And I just used those streetlights as one example.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But to budget for those things ahead of time and then not do them isn't getting us very far. I think we have to identify and budget for them appropriately and then do them when it comes up. Because right now we've got to get caught up with the things that need to get done, flooding, stormwater, things like that. So there's all sorts of stuff.
There's a lot of decisions that have to be made there that have not been made.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and in this decision, are we doing short shrift to the flood tactics that lie ahead of us?
Yeah.
Should we be building a reserve for that, or how should that be funded? Maybe we're looking outside the village for things of that nature. I don't know. Because that could be, depending on how that study comes in, those numbers could be.
Those numbers are going to be. We're talking 40 plus, 40 million plus, wasn't it?
I think
the start, yeah.
This is the Army Corps study?
Yeah.
Yes.
Do we have a completion date on that? I don't remember. Okay, because I did go to the meetings a while ago.
Yeah, a draft sometime in spring.
Okay.
But that won't be solved with this budget. No. So can we have a consensus to get direction for next Monday's meeting on how to, how to proceed?
December.
Go with the revised option?
It's an option seven. I have to present an option seven Monday night.
Okay, so Kim was just telling me with an option seven, we'll present option seven Monday night. And just so we're clear, it's the flat rate with 300,000 even?
Yes.
And for what it's worth in terms of votes, I'm supportive of that. However, I will not be at the meeting on Monday. I'll be out of town.
Okay.
Just to clarify, is it 300 or 450?
300 into the police pension fund, coupled.
Or the 1.4?
Yeah.
Okay. I just want to make sure if it was including the 150 or total is 300.
No, that was the 300.
Option
that was the
six has the 150 in it already. So is it option two plus 300 or option six plus 300? I just want to verify, make sure I'm understanding where you're.
My computer's about to restart.
Coming from, I'm sorry.
Oh, here.
No, I think option six with an additional $150,000 for a total of $300,741.
Okay.
Going to the police pension fund.
Got it.
If we want to just double it just for the sake of doubling it to 300,000.
I'm just making sure I'm on the same page.
Yeah.
That's all.
No,
okay.
That was.
Got it.
Okay. Anything else on that?
I don't think so.
Okay, public comment? Anyone else for public comment?
Mother told me I better shut up.
Excellent public comment. Village board, village staff comments, anyone?
I just have a question on anything, right?
Yeah.
The 27th is going to be the public something for the downtown plan. I don't know how that date was picked, but I think it conflicts with the school board meeting.
It does.
And that school board, my point is, however that date was picked, you're going to have two things that a lot of residents are going to want to go to both of those. Is there any chance of movement of the?
Well, I can further review with Housie Olivine and CMAP in terms of their availability. Part of it was picked because just knowing when we're getting the draft plan to allow for enough time for the public to look at it and be available. We'll also accept any written comments or questions or suggestions as well. And this is an open house. It's not a meeting that's going to have a two-hour presentation. It's come in and someone has a question and wants to directly ask that question, and it's 5-10 minutes.
I don't think you should have them on the same night.
We'll look into that. Again, I'm not sure of what, you know, between both of the consultants that we're working with, what their time frame was. That's something I'll need to look into.
I know there's always conflict, but I don't think that's a good setup.
I mean, if there's board direction to move the date, we'll work with Housiel to move the date. Is that
move the date?
Okay.
Thank you.
Do we have three meetings in December?
I believe we do.
We do.
Yes, three are scheduled.
Okay.
Unless there's.
Well, I think there's usually three scheduled, and sometimes the one dropped. But
we'll have to, the meeting of December will have to happen for tax levy.
The 18th.
Since we have another option now.
Okay.
Okay. Okay. Any other staff, village, board or staff comments? Okay. Let's consider this adjourned. Okay.